The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
Ready. This is very difficult for visitors. I say this. This is kind of like a just a warning in advance. This is a difficult church because we make a clear distinction between having Jesus as your Savior and having Him as Lord. Everything we teach and preach is how to more effectively make Him Lord of your life, because I believe we're on the verge of an awakening. I believe in many ways it's already, the winds have already begun to blow for refreshing and restoration, but it's going to increase in the days ahead. And the real battle line is going to be drawn not because Jesus is your Savior like life insurance, but whether He's Lord of every aspect of your life. And many years ago, I equipped a church that God gave me specific instructions to literally equip absolutely everybody. It was about 250 people in the church, and I would say 80% were active in the church from youth on up. The youth would stand on chairs and prophesy. They had flags, they had banners, they had everything, and four worship teams, various styles of dance, at least four different dance teams, and all of that to where everyone was participating, and I think it did a lot for their personal sense of well-being. It did affect them in the marketplace. You know, you build in the church, you equip properly in the church, and you establish people's character, and they are more confident in the marketplace. But then God said that now that everybody's doing it, you don't do that anymore. It's commonplace. I actually took a hit for all of that stuff. I took a hit for having dancing in the church. Can you imagine that? Vicky would have been you'd have been in trouble for sure. But what he's saying now is, I want you to equip for the lordship of Jesus in everyday life. It has to be training and equipping to live in the marketplace 24/7. And that means if you're a stay-at-home mom or if you're a student, it makes no difference. That's the world that you live in, but you're not of it. And how to rule and reign, and the phrase would actually be to advance the rule of the conquering king. Do you believe Jesus is your conquering king? Then we're going to advance his rule. So most of our messages are not easy because we expect you to do these. We expect you to check on you from last week's message. Are you just taking notes and hearing messages? Are you going to conferences and just taking notes and you're learning a lot up here? But how much of it is actually being applied? So we have a criteria that God used with me. I was the patient. And now that I'm the patient, I can be the doctor to tell you that you need to try this as a patient. First, when God reveals the truth to you out of the scriptures, whether it's in your private devotions or a sermon or what have you, when God speaks to you that truth, its intent is that you cultivate that truth. We call it homework, because you're supposed to actually live it, because there's going to be a fine demarcation. There's going to be a line drawn between those who have Jesus as their Savior and have fire insurance from their point of view and those who are living under the lordship. The warning is clear in Scripture. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord. It's easy to say, Lord, Lord. Did I not prophesy? Did I not cast out devils? And their qualification is going to be based on what they did. But I think Jason covered that definition last week in his message on the two trees. Did you notice that he says basically Savior is the work that God did, but Lord is his position, and that's whether or not we allow him to be Lord. Not just say Lord, allow him to be Lord. And so today's message is Adonai. Is God your Adonai? How many know that Adonai means Lord and Master? Lord and Master. If you've known or studied the names of God, it's the foundation. And if I was going to do everything over after 40 years in ministry, if I was going to start over again, there's two things that I would teach. One is where the location of your will is. Your will is not here. I want to make Jesus Lord, I need to know that my will is in the Bible heart. This is where you open the door of your heart. This is where your knower is. This is where Jesus came in and then informed your head. But he came into your heart, not this heart, this heart. And that needs to be emphasized because it's still radically transforming the church. Sometimes it's decades behind with all of the teaching. They get decades behind in experience. Do you believe we know more Bible than we're experiencing? Yeah, this country is biblically literate. It's not that there's a lack of word and availability to that word, but there's a lack of having that word become a subjective experience or reality. Truth is reality. So I want to change and turn the hourglass upside down on some concepts. And the concept number one that I did in understanding this. How many have said that identity is a major issue, your identity in Christ? However, you can actually study for years who I am in Christ, and the emphasis is still on you. Who I am in Christ is a beautiful teaching. As a matter of fact, it's foundational. It's absolutely essential. It's significant. However, you can still have the emphasis in the wrong place. Who I am in Christ, and it's like who am I in Christ? It's supposed to be the opposite. And so I want to give you a definition of the identity that I believe the Spirit of God is bringing into transformation to make ready a people prepared for an awakening. This is not the time for easy believism. This is not a time for saying all the right answers. This is a time for living in that answer, living in that relationship. So listen to this definition. This is the foundation. I'm a firm believer in foundations. I believe that you cannot give too much foundational truth because most people want deep teaching when in reality they need a deeper nature. One time God showed me, it was like an X-ray. He showed me over a congregation, and I must have been pastoring 6 months. And he showed me this vision of a black screen that went over, and everybody, just like an X-ray, it was like skeletons. And he showed me huge, humongous heads and little atrophied spirits that were almost starving. And it just broke my heart. So I'm saying, God doesn't want me to speak to their heads. He wants me to speak to their hearts. And he wants them to grow in grace and in the inner knowledge of God. Not head knowledge, inner knowledge. Knowing in their knower. And so here's the definition of the foundation of which I believe we're going. Your self-image will be complete, or another word you could use is mature. Your self-image will be complete or mature. And this is the whole purpose of naming this ministry, which is the umbrella over all the other ministries, Full Stature. Full Stature existed with the intent to bring the body of Christ unto maturity. No easy sell, everybody's okay, I'm okay, you're okay. Instead, we're going to say, no, God's going to search your heart. And we're going to allow him to remove any barriers. But your self-image will be complete or mature when you realize the complete image of who God wants to be in you. When you realize the complete image of who God wants to be in you. Did you see the shift there? It's not about you, is it? It's about him revealing his image in you. You are the vessel. He wants to be the expression. He wants his personality to be demonstrated through your life. It isn't all about you. That's hard for some people. Because in their insecurity, it's where do I fit? What's my niche? Where do I belong? You know how many times a pastor hears that? Where do I fit? It's not that that's a bad question, and it's not that God doesn't have placement for you. But what he has is he needs you to be more secure in the fact that it is no longer I that live, but Christ that lives through me. This life I live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself to me. We've got to enter into that love message to such a degree that we're not afraid to abandon ourselves to love. We don't feel insecure. But God wants to be his, write this down, this is easier, his personality in you. So the next time you hear teachings on, oh, what am I with Christ? Who am I in Christ? All of those wonderful teachings of who I am in Christ, make sure that you, your final last word is, but it's his personality going through me that identifies me. And some people, that brings fear into them because it's like, oh, I'll be lost. I know that when I had a church full of people that were moving into their identity, when I told them that there was a thing that's even a higher realm called a corporate identity and corporate giftings, some of them got terrified because it'd be like if we were all a bunch of potatoes, all of a sudden they pictured they were going to be mashed potatoes and cease to exist. They're so afraid of that term corporate. It meant you were insecure in your individual, or you would never be intimidated by corporate. Something bigger than yourself, becoming part of something bigger than yourself, guarantees you fulfillment in destiny. Destiny will always include people. Selfish, you can be successful and selfish. You can climb on people to get where you want to go, but you're going to end up all alone. Some of those successful people jump out of tall buildings too after they built the building. Destiny involves people and divine appointments and divine connections. And God says, I'm raising up an army. Make ready a people prepared, turning the hearts of the fathers to the children to the fathers. But I want to give you a test this morning, and this will be tested on next week to see if you accomplished it, because I will remind you next week. And that is God your Adonai, Lord and Master? From the time I was a baby Christian, I wanted to know the various names of God experientially. But this one you cannot know. Say that back to me. I cannot know without experience Jesus as Lord. It becomes a mental concept. If you do not make him Lord over the seven internal thrones of your life, and to the degree he is Lord over those seven internal thrones, you can give lip service to them. Even the scripture says, with their lips they praise me, but their heart is far from me. So you can live your whole Christian life saying all the right answers and being biblically literate and not have it really change or transform your life. Okay? So how many know some of the names of God? Slip up your hand if you just know some of them. Yeah. That's an exciting thing because they're all aspects of Jesus the Messiah, and he's revealing himself to you in various character and attributes. He said, my God shall supply all of my need according to his riches and glory. And when he declares a name, that is the actual nature that he is revealing supernaturally at that point in time. Sar Shalom. He revealed himself to Gideon, who's hiding away in a little pit trying to scrape out a meager living. By the way, God's just saying right now that there's somebody listening to this right now that you're scraping out a meager living as a Christian and you're wondering where it is. And God's basically saying it's because you've allowed fear to dominate your life and your finances have not been given to Jesus as Lord. He is not Lord of your finances. And you're afraid of what you're going to lose. And I really believe that he's speaking to someone that's very wealthy at this point too. That you're scared that you're losing everything, but it's because you've never made Jesus Lord. So it doesn't matter whether you're poor. There's a message out there for the poor person, and there's a message out there for the rich. Jesus needs to be Lord over your finances. Now, secondly, that was a side note. In the names of God, and he wants to get his personality through you, Elohim. How many have heard that one? Elohim. Elohim is plural. It's the God of power and might, sovereignty. He's the God who makes covenants. Elohim makes covenants with his people. He's the creator God. If you want to know the purpose of a thing, ask the creator, not the thing. You see what our world is deteriorating? It's people asking and figuring out who they are without inquiring of the one that made you. You come up with ridiculous conclusions, by the way. It's like talking to your VCR and saying, tell me, what do you do? Who are you? You probably won't get an answer. You need to go to the manufacturer if you really want to understand that VCR. All right? Jehovah. How many have heard Jehovah? Jehovah. That's the to be or being. So when you see Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah, that means he's the revealing one. He wants to reveal himself. Jehovah is the revealing one. Pay attention to what comes after Jehovah, because that's exactly what he's trying to reveal to you. El Shaddai, the God who is more than enough, the God of blessing, abundance, the mighty breasted one, nourishment, productiveness, the God who is more than enough. When I didn't understand, when I was a baby Christian, I saw the multiplication of the loaves and the fishes. Do you ever reason with stuff in the scripture and get confused sometimes? I was confused over God's stewardship when he multiplied the loaves and the fishes and he didn't count right. And he made too many. There was leftovers. And that little question with God, like, if God's perfect, why didn't he count perfect? You know, a little OCD on Dennis's part, probably. But what was interesting is then when I really sought to know him as the God who multiplied like that, he revealed himself as El Shaddai to me, and it was one of the greatest questions I ever asked God, because it was one of the greatest revelations. He said, I am always more than enough. And you know what that does? It puts you in a God confidence to where you don't look and constantly say, oh God, I need this, I need that. You know what it did? It switched something over for me, that if he was more than enough and he supplies all of my need according to his riches and glory, that the very inner workings of me was that I only wanted him, not stuff. Isn't that a nice transition to when you don't want stuff? I don't pray for stuff. I don't pray for cars, refrigerators. I don't pray for those things. I basically pray for more of him. If I've got daddy, that's better than $5, right? I've got him. And so that was the transition, all out of my silly question of why God couldn't count right, and there was leftovers. All right. So the one that we're getting to now is Adonai, ownership. And that's going to be a significant preparation for the days ahead and for what God wants to accomplish. He wants us to know him as Adonai. How many are game to allow this to happen? Because you can stay in the church as your savior for years. As a matter of fact, Adonai is your part. The three most significant scriptures, we covered this, I think, in previous weeks, but I just love it. It's the verses of scripture in Isaiah 43:11, Isaiah 43:25, and Isaiah 51:12. And you say, what are these? These are the three, and I want my church to memorize these three. I want you to look these up, because these are the expression of the Father God in the Old Covenant, to where our friend who Bill Morford, who is a biblical scholar, has developed the book, the Bible, One New Man. How many of you have heard the One New Man Bible? All right, that's his. He discovered something that all the double I ams, I am, is in there for emphasis, that God is emphasizing. But he said he found out of 33 or so double I ams, he found three I ams that were different than all the rest. And what was different about them was God was really intense when he said it. He said there's no other way to explain it in the Hebrew other than God was really intense. I am is pretty intense. Just saying it twice means truly, truly, verily, verily, better pay attention, right? But he said, I am your Savior, and there's none that can save you besides me. I am, and I've got an attitude. These three elements, if a Christian were to take these three elements and hunger and thirst to know him and be allow this his personality to get through you, you would see a remarkable transformation in a very short period of time. I am your Savior, and there's no one else that can deliver you. I am your deliverer. I can deliver you from any and all sin. I am your only Savior. So much for many ways to God, too, right? I am your Savior, and no one else can deliver you. The second one is, I am the one who blots out your transgressions. I am the one that forgives sin and no one else can. I am, and I have an attitude. I am your forgiver. I blot out your sins. So I am your Savior, Deliverer. Deliverer is actually a better translation. Most of our Bibles say Savior. But I am your Savior. I am your Deliverer. I am the one that forgives you. And the last one is, I am the one that comforts you. All other comforts are false comforts. All other comforts are man-made. All other comforts are things that you found to soothe yourself, but they're like Band-Aids. They will not work. And then God said, basically, Dennis, if you are going to be a son that reflects this heart of the Father, because you notice none of these things are on our part. This is all God's part. He's doing this for us. You didn't do anything yet. He's just saying, this is my provision. I'm your deliverer, and I'll deliver you from any sin. There's nothing I can't deliver you from. I am, and I'm the only one that can do it. I am the only one that can cleanse you and make you clean again and take disqualified people and people who have disqualified themselves or been disqualified by other people. I can qualify again and wash clean and make it white as snow. I don't care if your sin was as red as crimson. I can make it white as snow. I and I alone am the forgiver. You don't do anything. You have to allow me to cleanse and wash. Nobody else can do this. And the last one, I am your comforter, and nobody else can comfort you. Everything else is a Band-Aid or a false comfort. And then what does he say? If you're my child, here's what I want you to do. I want you to be a deliverer. I want you to be one who is in the ministry of reconciliation. I want you to have a redemptive mindset that whenever you see something wrong, then you say, I want to be part of the solution to that something that's wrong. If nothing else, I'm going to pray and intercede. I'm going to have a solution-oriented mindset because my God equipped me to be like him. And he's a solution-oriented God. No matter what problem there is, he died on a cross for that problem. And he says, you likewise go ye into all the world and be solution oriented. So the next time you see something wrong in the body of Christ or elsewhere, you say, to what degree is my Father calling me to be part of the solution? The least case scenario, I can pray. I can release loving intercession and have a redemptive mindset. Because anybody can be a fault finder or a problem finder. That's not difficult. You don't even have to be saved to do that. But to say, to what degree was I willing to be a solution-oriented person? The second thing is that I'm going to walk a forgiveness lifestyle. Everybody at Kingdom Life Church, Full Stature Ministry, we're known for one thing, and that is forgiveness is the love message where the rubber meets the road, and that's where you need to go as far as keeping the connection to the Lordship of Jesus. I'm going to live a forgiveness lifestyle. Forgiveness does not condone what someone else has done. It frees you emotionally from being controlled. When you are free from their control, you are under God's control, or at least a candidate to be under God's control. Jesus is Lord. The third one is comfort. If he's the only true comfort, and we're true children reflecting his personality, isn't that maturity? Reflecting his personality through us? Then he'd be living through it. He'd comfort them with the same comfort that you were comforted in your time of affliction. So even take your afflictions and turn them into testimonies and use that to minister life to other people. Instead of bawling and crying about your problems, instead, you know, don't waste those sorrows. Bring them to death on the cross and let resurrection life flow through and let it become a blessing to somebody else. Let Jesus bring through death, burial, and resurrection real life. I haven't gotten into the message yet. A lot of preliminary stuff here. I wanted to get into nine elements, but I didn't want to scare you with the number nine. You go, oh, nine, and he's only on one. Sometimes that's a bad preaching habit, but I do it anyway, all right? You're not going to be afraid. I'll go through them real quick, all right? But when I began to look at what God was saying in these days, he said, the Son of Righteousness is going to start rising with healing in his wings. And to me, this is a thus saith the Lord. You watch, that Son of Righteousness is on the inside of you. And as you welcome him to be Lord over the seven internal thrones, if you don't know the seven internal thrones, you have to come to this church on a regular basis because we deal with those seven internal thrones. You've heard teachings on the seven mountains? That's out there. If you don't get the seven internal thrones where the Lordship of Jesus is ruling, you're probably not much good out there in the seven mountains. You'll probably slip. I want to take you from the base camp at the foot of the mountain to the place where the air is so thin you can only breathe Holy Spirit. You won't have the energy to be in the flesh. You will be so enraptured in the higher life that the lower life will lose all its appeal. And that's through the work of the cross, but it's through resurrection life coming, taking that which passes through death yet lives. I like that statement, don't you? That which passes through death yet lives. He's not out to destroy your mind, will, and emotions. He's out to inspire them by his Spirit and bring them to a more heavenly perspective, to put wisdom in there of application on how to live life. All right. So anyway, I believe that the people who sit in darkness are going to see a great light. And I believe that even individually, areas that have been dark to us are going to suddenly become light because the sun of righteousness is going to rise with healing. Whereas the day spring is going to arise in our heart. Whereas a new day, arise, shine, for your light has come. I know God is speaking this right now. So don't be surprised as God begins to show you things that you say, I've been in church for 35 years and all of a sudden I'm seeing this and I'm seeing that and I'm seeing this. And it's going to be like you're in this beautiful aquarium with all these beautiful South Pacific fishes, and there's yellow ones and there's striped ones and there's all these beautiful angel fish and all these things, and you're going to go, oh, but what do I do with all of that? Where do I start? That's when you get first step, and you start first step with the 60-day challenge, and there's a real practical way to get started, because there's so many beautiful things that are going to start rising up in your heart, but you got to know where to put them. You need total concept. All right, and God's saying, I'm going to basically lay out a challenge to my people, and I'm going to cause them to mature, but mature my way, and that is my personality through them, not who am I, where do I fit, where do I belong, okay? I don't mean to be sarcastic with that, but I've heard that for 40 years. That's carnality, because when you're really secure in your Lord, you're not asking those questions. You're saying, I'm part of something bigger than myself, and I'm fulfilled to be part of a team. We didn't name team by accident. Team is to totally equip all missionaries or a training embassy for advanced ministry. That applies to everybody. But we like to specialize sometimes with the missionaries. Because I've had too many missionaries over 40 years that came to me for one-on-one appointments because they shipwrecked on the mission field. I want them to have the tools before they go to the mission field. I've seen it for too many years. It's got to cease. And PTSD, which now they call PTSI, that is not difficult to deal with that. And yet that even exists on the mission field. Do you know that? That's a fear-based, it's the wrong kingdom, and it can be dealt with. Jesus is more than capable of dealing with that, and it does not take 10 years in counseling. Thank God for the experts, or some people wouldn't be here with us today, in generally speaking, if it wasn't for the experts. But if God brings an acceleration by the Spirit, I'm going to choose the Spirit and the acceleration, aren't you? So, anyway, are you ready for the 9 points real quick? Here's the transformation. The transformation is how to make him Adonai, Lord and Master. It's Lord and Master means that I will never get a revelation of him as Lord and Master until I surrender or submit to it. He will not force himself on you. And many, many are in the valley of decision. They've been saved for many years and very secure in church that makes you feel good and say, you're okay, I'm okay, we're all okay. God understands. Do you know that's actually a childish, immature attitude? God understands that I'm carnal. After all, I'm only human. Have you ever heard that? Maybe you've said it. If you said it, receive forgiveness right now. I'm only human. Because Jesus walked as a man and showed us what a human was supposed to act like. What you're talking about is subhuman. So don't just say I was just human. No, you are subhuman in your behavior. It's the fallen nature. You need to be like Jesus, who showed us what being human is all about. A victorious overcomer. And we are more than conquerors, all right? Element number one that must change. Element number one that must change, if God is going to be your Adonai, is it's going to be a God-focused life versus a self-focused life. A good place to start from a scriptural basis is Philippians 3:10 in the Amplified Bible. If you're serious about making Jesus Lord, then here is the truth that if properly cultivated will change your life in a short period of time. Philippians 3:10, I'm going to read it in the Amplified because it's very specific. For my determined purpose. Most of you don't know what your purpose is. You're still searching for purpose. Start with this purpose and the other purposes will come to fruition. My determined purpose, if it's good enough for Paul, it's good enough for me, it's good enough for you. My determined purpose is that I might know him. Don't go any farther than that. Because if you try to go farther than that and learn all kinds of clever little things, five steps to this and three steps to that, you're moving in a formula and not a relationship. I like the three steps to this and four steps to that, if it's all relational. If it's not all relational, it's just a formula. For my determined purpose is that I might know him, that I might progressively, it's not overnight, is it? That I might progressively become more intimately acquainted with him, perceiving and recognizing and understanding the wonders of his person. I fell in love with that as a baby Christian, and I've never fallen out of love because he keeps revealing himself. And I believe that even when we go to heaven, he's going to keep on revealing himself. Do you ever see a disco ball with all those little mirrored? I believe we're going to go to heaven. No matter how well we know him down here, when we're in heaven, we're still going to go, holy, oh, wow, whoa, I never saw that before. Whoa, he's just going to keep shining his face on our heart and change us from glory to glory, faith to faith. I don't believe it's ever going to end. I believe that he is so all-knowing, all-sufficient that we could spend all eternity being totally thrilled and amazed at the wonders of his person. But while you're here on earth, you only know him to the degree that you know him. And you probably know, look where I'm pointing, you know more than you know. Mm-hmm. But the change is going to take place with this step. This first element will bring Adonai, or Jesus as Lord. You see, if people that are real comfortable with Jesus being your Savior, you're not going to like it here. Because we actually challenge you to live the life. Because you can get gospel hard getting sermon after sermon, going to conference after conference, and you're learning and learning and learning and never coming to an understanding of the truth. Because the truth is reality, and it's subjective, and it needs to be in your knower, not your head. Many will say to me in that day, did I not cast out devils? Lord, Lord. So it's easier to say it than isn't it? And you can justify Lord, Lord by prophesying, casting out devils. We've spent 40 years dealing with people who prophesied, cast out devils, and crashed and burned. Didn't we, Jennifer? That is not the badge of maturity. The badge of maturity is the character development of him expressing himself through you. And he can't express something through you that never shone on our hearts in the face of Jesus Christ. When you say the face of Jesus, that actually means his presence, not his physical face. Face to face is spirit to spirit, breath to breath, heart to heart. Element number two. This is for all you people who have loved to have counseling from time to time. And thank God for the experts. Some of you wouldn't be here if it wasn't for counseling. Nevertheless, by the Spirit. Element number two is God saying there needs to be a transition to Adonai, to where you are God-searched versus self-searched. How many know the difference? What's self-search? That's something you do in your head and you go, I can't think of anybody to forgive. Oh yeah, you close your eyes and you ask God to show you. You let God search your heart. You let God search your heart, and all of a sudden you're going to come up with all kinds of stuff. Element number two to making Jesus Lord is that you certainly are never afraid. As a matter of fact, when I've raised up leadership over the years, the person that was afraid to get ministry from me and that wasn't going to make it as a leader. Why? They're afraid of what someone else would see. The way you treat people is the way you treat God. The way you treat God is the way you treat people. I love God, you got to love people. You can't, it's not, I love God, but these people. That's not going to work. That's saying there's something wrong in the heart. So element number two is God searched versus self-searched. Self-search and analysis and self-help books, I don't have any confidence in them, because if someone put me together, my creator, he's the one I want searching my heart. He's the true counselor. He even calls himself the counselor, doesn't he? Wonderful counselor, mighty God, Prince of Peace. Third element, God protected. This is something our peace book emphasizes, and some people tried to start with our peace book and got a little frustrated because they realized how very little of peace they had in their life. And that's intimidating. Be anxious for nothing, but all things prayer. Prayer for me is being in the presence of God with the peace of God as a constant. If you are a spirit-filled Christian and live in low-grade anxiety most of the time, he's not Lord. He's your Savior, but he's not Lord. You can't be anxious and trusting God at the same time. You're trusting in yourself or someone else, some other person, place, or thing. Do you feel attacked, rejected, dismissed, disrespected? Do you feel competitive? Are you angry a lot? All of those are indications that you have not walked into God protection, but you're into self-protection. Self-protection, just to show you, we'd go to some of the largest churches in New England, and when we did this, 99.9% knew what we were talking about. We would approach it from the flesh. We would say, you just run into the last person on the face of the earth you wanted to see today. And what did you do when they were coming towards you? The first thing you did, right down here, you went, nod your head if you know what I'm talking about. Hi. You're forced to listen to them and confront them mentally, but what you just did, that wall is self-protection, and it doesn't work. If you're ever going to grow up before you go up, you're going to have to trust God's peace will guard your heart and your mind through Christ Jesus. But you'll never know that unless you practice it. The next time you're in a hostile environment, drop down to your spirit and face that hostile person. And I don't care if they're the demon on wheels and they're spewing forth poison. You will feel what's coming at you, but it will not penetrate the peace of God. You cannot touch. The peace of God will keep you, and the evil one cannot penetrate that. Peace is armor. It either guards your heart and your mind, as the scripture says, or you don't believe it, and you're going to try your own. Well, how's that been working for you? Isn't that what Jennifer learned as a psychologist, is reality therapy? So how is what you're doing working? If it's not working well, would you like another plan? Right? Well, I'm giving you the other plan, and that is God protected as opposed to self-protection, opposed to spending and wasting most of your life being, I'm attacked, I'm rejected. How come when I'm with leaders, they're not as attacked as you are? That's my question. Wouldn't it be better strategy to smite the shepherd and the sheep be scattered? A lot of your attack is your own carnality beating you up. It's not even demonic. I mean, you can get some demonic help, but you're beating yourself up. Failing to allow the peace of God to rule, or the lordship of Adonai. So you want to be God protected, not self protected. God's peace will garrison and mount guard over your heart and mind. That's Philippians 4:7 in the Amplified. Beautiful translation. Jesus, who was born of God, keeps him, that is the believer, from the relentless temptation and snare of the wicked one. That's a promise, isn't it? He'll protect you. He'll keep you from it. But there's God's part and there's your part. For him to do his part, you need to respond and let him be Lord. Let the peace of God rule. Who's ruling? You in self-protection or God in God protection? Element number four. Some people were upset with this word many years ago when I preached it, but I'm old enough now that I say what I want to say, and if you get upset, then I'll pray for you and love you and release loving intercession for you. But they didn't like the word possessed. But you know what? I want to be God possessed. I'm not talking demons. I'm talking about being God possessed. That doesn't mean I don't have a free will. It just means flooded with God, flooded with God. Thank God I'm flooded with God. I want to be filled with all the fullness of God. So if I use a word like possessed, it doesn't relinquish my free will. But what it does is saying, I want every nook and cranny under his lordship. And so God possessed versus self-possessed. But here's the way a person who has an ownership problem manifests. If you are not God possessed, you have an ownership problem. I was here first. That's my niche. What can I get for nothing? We used to call those one-way relationships, and Jennifer goes, when you say one-way relationships, people don't understand what you're talking about. When I say one-way relationship, it's gimme, 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 and I ain't doing nothing. Now, is that clear? It's like, gimme, gimme, gimme. There's like contributors, and then there's consumers. Consumers want, and never really get. And they never give. That's not the way the heart works, though. It's giving and receiving. Each one does its share of giving and receiving. Two-way relationship is not, I once had a man wanted mentored. What he wanted me to do was to spend all of my time pouring into him, and he would do nothing. He would let the ladies fold chairs and put tables away, and he'd stand and watch. And I'm going, what kind of upbringing did you have? Huh? But he was upset that, I think it's a little narcissistic to think that maybe the whole world should help me because I'm special. I want to take that word special and get it back to Jesus. Yes, you are special. You have intrinsic value, but your value is never expressed unless he's Lord. So you're never that special until you get his interpretation or definition of it. So element number four, we have a scripture for this, by the way, that when we traveled and would minister to people, we just kept using it over and over again because it was like, how do you teach people who have ownership problems to relinquish ownership back to Jesus? How do we teach them to do that? And we found one in Romans 14:4 in the Living Bible. Of all the translations, that was the one that just, it connected with the way they were doing. We would say, here's Romans 14:4 in the Living Bible, and that's an old Living Bible even, published around 71 to 79, somewhere in there. But anyway, they are God's servants, not yours. Say that out loud with me. They are God's servants, not mine. That means your kids. Whoa, you can get some mothers really angry on that one. No, they're God's. You are a steward. You are not an owner. God's going to hold you account for your stewardship. You don't own the vineyard. They are God's servants, not yours. They're responsible to him and not to you. Whoa, that'll work on some moms. Dads too. Let him tell them whether they're right or wrong, and God is able to make them do as they should. You have some rebellious teenagers? I'll guarantee you there is nothing as powerful as releasing love to them while they're in their rebellion and not trying to make them do anything. I mean, when I had that attitude, I caught my boys and Allison every time because God knew that the intent was redemptive and not punishment. I mean, I can remember pulling out of our subdivision, there's only one way to go to get out, left. And the car went like that. And I turned right and I went down. And all of a sudden, there was this car with the black tinted windows and the side door opened up and this leg came out. And I'm going, I know, that's Allison's leg. I recognize that leg anywhere. That's Allison's leg. And then she looked horrified when I pulled up and rolled a window down next to her. I caught her at the swimming pool. I caught her. God even gave me a word of knowledge that one time where she figured out we have an alarm system where the door buzzes when you open the door, close the door. Well, this is a no-no. We gave a teenager a bedroom with an outside exit.
Don't tell them how she did it.
We don't want
people getting ideas.
Yeah. She figured out a way how she could sneak out at night and the buzzer wouldn't go off. And I'm walking outside and I'm going, a word of knowledge, check her door. Okay, I went and checked her door, and I fixed it so the buzzer would work. And then I'm in her room, and I'm saying, oh, come on, let's go. We can go outside. Let's go out your door. Oh no. And I opened the door, and the buzzer went off, and she went. She was horrified. It worked. All right. They are God's servants, not yours. They belong to him and not to you. And God is able to tell them whether they're right or wrong. And God is able to make them do as you should. Your responsibility is to release love to them. That doesn't mean that there's not consequences for behavior. It simply means the attitude of your heart trumps punishment. You know how many children I dealt with, preteen and teens, that basically said, I want to do the dishes for my mother. But when she pushes, if you would stop pushing. Pushing feels on a human spirit like witchcraft. It's control. You can get the same result without the push and have a consequence when something's not done, but you can do it all out of the love of God. This is not rocket science. This is workable. This is doable. And it's actually required by God that if he's Lord, you learn how to do this. If you don't know how to do what I'm saying, you're already guilty now, because now you've, with more information comes more responsibility. Now you've got to learn how to love people that are disobedient. A redemptive-oriented person does not mean you condone their behavior. It does not mean that there isn't consequence. It simply means your attitude maintains lordship, and that therefore that person or that action no longer controls you. Element number 5. This is for people who basically have their emotions out of control. Kind of like the histrionic. How many know what a histrionic is? That's a hysterical personality disorder. The sky's always falling. I mean, if they stub their toe, they have a meltdown over stubbing their toe. It's the worst thing that could have ever happened. Yes, one person, two people in the same dilemma, two people in the identical situation. How's it going? Oh, it was rough today. The other one, oh my God, it's the end of the world. I want to commit suicide. I'm going to, same circumstance, same situation. One is an over-exaggeration of emotions, but God basically saying your primary emotion is anger, fear, guilt, shame. Overly excited, well, one minute they're on a high, and the next minute they're crashed and they're depressed. All right? What is that? What do they call that? Bipolar? Two extremes? Well, guess what? You're all bipolar to a degree. It's just a question of degree, right? We want to get your degree to where you're more balanced, stable, secure. All right? So the next time you look at somebody that's bipolar, say, except for the grace of God, there go I. If it wasn't for the restraint of the Holy Spirit, I'd be like that too. Could be. So element number 5 is basically let the peace of God rule in your heart. Peace with God. Pursue peace with all people. The God of peace will crush Satan beneath your feet, but you've got to try it or you'll never know. God ruled versus self-ruled. Actually, that's what this whole thing is about, but you need it in a practical way to realize that when self is on the throne, the one thing that's missing is peace. Oh, you might be getting your way, you might be doing whatever you wanted, but when you're self-ruled, you're on the throne, there is no peace. I'm sorry. Whatever you get for peace, you're going to have to get through medication or a false comfort, eat a lot of donuts or whatever turns you on, but that's really the only peace you're going to get. And Christians, quit using this thing. You can't, too much of the body is very discerning. When you go, I want what I want and I want it now, that's called lust. You say, I have a peace about it. I have a peace about it. Don't abuse the word of God like that. That's not peace. That's basically a lustful satisfaction that I want what I want, and I want it now, and I'm going to get it. But I have a peace about it. That's not peace. That's a false peace. God's talking about all of the doctrines of Jesus are doctrines of peace. Did you know that? There's not one doctrine in the Bible from Jesus that doesn't lead to peace. Peace with God, peace with man. Peace, that includes peace with yourself. And the God of peace will crush Satan beneath your feet. I'm believing for a church and a generation that's going to rise up, and they're going to know the supernatural peace of God to such a degree that they're going to walk victoriously, because it will crush the enemy. God purposely chose Jehovah Shalom to crush the enemy. He could have said the Lord of hosts of the armies of God, or Jehovah Sabaoth, the commander in chief of the Lord army. But he says, and the God Shalom shall crush the enemy beneath your feet. The kingdom of God is peace, righteousness, peace, and joy. You could actually say love, joy, peace is the kingdom of God. It's the fruit of the Spirit and the rule of God. Where the rule of God is, there's his kingdom. Where his kingdom is, there's love, joy, and peace. Element number six. Listen to this one closely, because I saw this one emerged in Jason's teaching last week. It's God sufficient versus self-sufficient. The enemy's oldest tactic is to say that somehow God is holding something back from you. That's as old as the garden. Somehow God is holding something good from you. Isn't that interesting? Good. The tree of knowledge of good and evil, he doesn't show you the evil. He shows you the good that you could have, that Christianity and a relationship with Jesus is keeping you from having. It's the oldest trick in a book, but it works. He's withholding something good. And you begin to say, I need this, I need that. I'll tell you what, when you make Jesus Lord, you know what you begin to find out is that my God shall supply all of my need according to his riches and glory. I need to go to the place of glory to have that need met. Wherever you're trying to help God out because you feel God's not meeting your need, there's probably an area where if you don't like the fruit, there's probably a root. If you don't like the fruit, there's probably a root. If on the seven thrones of your life, there's an area that is habitually bombarding you, it's not because it's just God picking on you or the devil picking on you. You've given place to it and have given him permission to pick on you in that area, because Jesus is probably not likely Lord in that area if that remains over a long period of time. Short term, could be pruning you. Long term, there's an area that you've not surrendered to his lordship. My God shall supply all of my need, and his strength is made perfect in weakness, if in that weakness you turn to him and not to your own ability. God's sufficiency versus self-sufficiency. Because the scripture says, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think of anything as being from ourselves, but our sufficiency is from God, who also made us sufficient. This is where you start to get healthy under lordship. God is able, his word is able, and he made you able. God wants to deliver out of mediocrity the average believer and rise up into maturity and the priesthood of the believer. Mediocrity is basically a failure to think that you are able. There's something wrong with me. I'm not worthy. I'm damaged goods. This is one of the first major healings that I administered to Jennifer when we first got married, wasn't it? There must be something wrong with me. There must be something wrong with me. People are doing that all through the body of Christ, and that's the trick of the enemy. There's nothing wrong with you except believing that there's something wrong with you. Let God search your heart and he'll deal with anything that's wrong. But you can't take your entire identity, because it will keep you stymied into mediocrity and not reach your maximum potential in God. I see potential in people, but I can't convince them that God could do so much more in their life until they get convinced. Do you agree with that? It breaks my heart, because I see potential. But as Glenn would say, you know what potential means? Means you haven't done it yet. What's that mean? Means you're going to have to try and trust God. Potential is a beautiful thing, But if you do nothing with it, I even believe the day's coming when you'll be rebuked for your lack of trying to utilize what God put in you. With the parable of the talents. Okay. Number 7. False comfort versus God's comfort. We kind of touched on that in the beginning, didn't we? The God of all comfort. Comfort them with the same comfort whereby I comforted you. Do you realize that if you're walking around as the wounded body of Christ or the brokenhearted, you cannot comfort someone in the same place that you yourself are not comforted? And you know, some people are even calling ministry, and you could pick this up by discernment. Someone who's broken in one area goes over and hugs someone else who's broken in that area because they identify. Identify does not release anointing. It's sympathy. It looks nice. But if it doesn't bring life to that other person, you're just commiserating with someone who's in the same situation you are. It is a non-redemptive act, and it's not ministry, and many call it ministry. Oh, I just know so-and-so is hurting, because you've got the same hurt in there. You're not doing it from discernment. You're doing it from identification. You're not healed yourself. You're not giving them life. How many people did we pray for over the years that were ready or already engaged in crisis pregnancy counseling, and they wanted to help girls to prevent them from having abortions. They themselves had an abortion. But what we found out was, even though that's a wonderful cause that they were in, many of them weren't healed themselves yet. You can make something a cause because you want to help people sincerely, but until you get healed up, you're not really releasing very much anointing. Unsaved people could feed somebody, but it's not necessarily going to bring them any salvation. So God's saying, I am he who comforts you, and no one can comfort you like me. Everything else is a false comfort. But I will guard him and keep him in constant peace whose mind is stayed on me. He leans on me, hopes in me. The God of all comfort who comforts us all in our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the same comfort which we ourselves are comforted by God. You can't give comfort that you yourself don't have. That comfort has to be Holy Spirit, and it has to be under the Lordship of Jesus. After Jesus comforts you in your time of affliction and you handle it properly, then you've got something to give. You can't give something you don't have. And you can't receive something you're not open to receiving. Element number 8. We're getting close, people. Do you see this? Can you tell? Oh, those of you. There was 9 elements, and we're on 8. You know, look at your watch and say, oh, it's getting there. But I have this long conclusion. No. Number 8. And this is something that I believe that I want to believe for all Kingdom Life people. God satisfied versus self-satisfied. Proverbs 14:14, the backslider in heart will be filled with his own ways. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be filled with my own ways. Even those ones that look right. I have a good idea. Good idea is not necessarily a God idea, right? The backslider in heart will be filled with his own ways, but a good man will be satisfied, filled to the full from above. And then Jeremiah 31:14, I will satiate or fill to the full the soul of the priests with abundance, and then my people shall be satisfied with my goodness, says the Lord. Jason covered that last week. Satisfied with his goodness. One of the easiest ways to get sidetracked is to think that God's withholding something good, because then you'll do what? You'll try to get it yourself. It's the oldest trick in the book. He's holding back something good. And it works. It works on the most mature Christian. But if we can identify that we're getting off focus, and say, my satisfaction is him. One of the greatest transitions in my life was basically saying, he is my exceedingly great reward. And actually had Christians make me feel bad when I was a young Christian because I didn't pray for stuff. Like I wasn't doing my part in the kingdom. I didn't pray for refrigerators, cars, new houses, carpeting, even though I had those legitimate needs. But you know what? I wanted more of him, that I might know him, that I might progressively become more intimately acquainted. And if there was an aspect of his character, his nature, I wanted to know it experientially. And you know what? He supplied me supernaturally with 1, 2, 3, 4 houses, cars, refrigerators, and I never prayed for one of them. And they were all supernatural. So if you seek first the kingdom, all these things will be added unto you is really true. I think we spend too much time asking God for something that he already knows what you have need of. If your priorities were in line, these things would be added unto you. It's not wrong to pray for those things, but I saw a lot of people wasting their time in disappointment and discouragement praying specifically for things that I understand that honors God, but your whole perspective needs to be him. If you've got him, you've got everything. Make him Lord and then pray for things as the Spirit leads you. But when you just see, oh, I need, that's it, you become needy. And the emphasis is on what you need, not on my God who will supply all of my need according to his riches and glory. There is nothing more beautiful than that prayer of saying, for God himself is my exceedingly great reward. When he's your exceedingly great reward, you can go and receive all of those other things. Element number 8 is to be so satisfied in God that self-satisfaction doesn't mean anything anymore. Element number 9. God's presence versus self-awareness. Did you know this is what's taught in all our higher schools of higher education? Self-awareness. You're special. It's the wrong kind of identity teaching. You're so special that society owes you a living. It's the fairness doctrine. It's only fair because you're so special. Do you know what Edgar Hoover, who was at one time, J. Edgar Hoover, something like that. J. Edgar Hoover, head of the FBI, at one time said the definition of a juvenile delinquent was someone who thought society owed him a living. Boy, that's deteriorated. Now everybody is raising a generation, well, of course society owes me a living. It's those people that need to provide for me. What's one of the definitions of socialism? The problem with socialism? Eventually you run out of other people's money. That's what happens. Distribute the wealth until there's no more to distribute. That comes from a concept of there's a pie and there's only so many pieces. So we better make sure we get our piece, right? Even if you have to fight for it. Get your peace. This country was founded that they even tried that in the early colonies and it didn't work. And the guys with the bad backs that couldn't work came with the biggest basket at handout time. Is that the carnal nature? That would be the carnal nature, wouldn't it? These are Christians. But then all of a sudden they said, we have a new principle going on in here. This isn't work. They went back to the scriptures. You don't work, you don't eat. They went, you don't work, you don't eat. And the guy with the bad back, his back got better. And nobody starved. That concept's been removed. But it's a kingdom concept. Give and you shall receive. Pressed down, shaken together, and running over. But you've got to give in the kingdom. God's presence versus self-awareness. We live in a narcissistic society, and it's like everybody should make me happy. It's not about other people making you happy. If I just had a woman, if I just had a man, I'd be happy. I've been around too long for that one. It's like, if you have that attitude, I just need a man, I just need a woman, I just need a man. This is for the single people, obviously. I just need a man, I just need a woman. I just put that on Facebook, didn't I, recently? Somebody's little quote I thought was clever. It says, when you think, and it's deceitful how intoxicating that relationship could be, that intoxicating relationship could have you come together and plow through dozens of red flags the rest of your life. Why didn't I see that red flag in that relationship? Why couldn't I tell that my boyfriend was on cocaine, alcoholic, and why didn't I see that then? He was so nice. He's going to change. I'm going to change him. Isn't that funny when they did single kids in, the ninth grade? They says, boys, how many of you, when you get married, your wife is going to change you? It was like 100%, no way. Girls, how many of you girls are going to change your husband and make him into the image? And they all thought they could. I think we could have the beginning of a problem. We could have a relational crash with women thinking you're going to change the man, and the man going, no, he's never going to change. Nobody's going to change me. No woman going to tell me what to do, right? That's an accident going somewhere to happen. God's looking for unity. I'll tell you what, I want to believe for a corporate anointing for husbands and wives, proper relationships that God brings you, and he'll bring them from around the world to supernaturally get the person whose heart is right, won't he? And what I'm looking for, I believe Jennifer and I are a picture of that. She pointed that out. The perfect example of what I believe is a corporate anointing is when a husband and wife, a family, and a church family become interdependent, not codependent, interdependent. And it's like, I am fulfilling my destiny because Jennifer is writing the books and taking down the information of what I taught her in the spirit. Without Jennifer, nothing would be out there. I would still have my gifting, I could still do it. But if one can chase 1,000, 2, 10,000, there's something about unity that pleases the heart of Jesus and his prayer in John 17. Jennifer would have had nothing to write about, to write the books, had I not been in her life to teach her what I taught her. So that's interdependent as opposed to codependent. Interdependent is what God could put Jennifer and I together, and a kingdom-like church together as a family. What we could do corporately exceeds. It is the opposite of codependent. Codependent is me and Jennifer could live in our own little world, and it's bless us and nobody else. And I feed off of you, and you feed off of me, but we have absolutely no impact to anyone else other than us. That is the epitome of selfishness. And there are codependent relationships where people say, oh, they have a wonderful marriage. No, they don't. That's a selfish relationship of codependence where I'm good for you and you're good for me and we have each other and we just go in a little circle like a little chipmunk on a wheel. But we are not part of anything bigger than our selfish self. We have not the capacity or the maturity to become part of something bigger than us. It's all about me and my needs. Can you see the difference? God wants to raise up the prayer of Jesus in John 17 and create a group, 2, 4, 10, 20. But it's going to be unity and a cause bigger than themselves. Become part of something bigger. In this day and age, too, there's even this thing about young people being told about their ministry. And you got a bunch of individual people thinking they got a ministry. Everybody wasn't called to a ministry. You were called to be a minister, but you weren't called to head up your own ministry. That's where the deception. The problem is you're not mature enough to work in something bigger than you. So everybody's doing their own thing. Remember, we even heard young people, just devastated me, young people saying, you're going to get a job? Aren't you afraid that's going to destroy your ministry? I'm saying, you know what? If you want to grow up and mature, get a job, get married, and have kids. Be a real man or a real woman. Find out what life's all about instead of this Pollyanna ministry that I'm going to be part of. I mean, there's people that think that they're going to go live on vacation their whole life on the mission field or in the world and just travel and have fun and think their ministry is going to fall out of the sky because they're special. They never paid the price to become part of something bigger than themselves. That ministry is not going to fall out of the sky. You've never become part of something bigger than yourself. You're codependent on you, yourself, and I. You have a three-way relationship with yourself, me, myself, and I. Multiple personalities. You want to make Jesus Lord with me, myself, and I? Get all three of them to tithe. That'd cure you real quick. All of a sudden, you'd be healed. Oh, there's just me. There's just me here. Our purpose is life is found in how close we get to God and how we make him Adonai. So, Father, I just pray that the very opposite of the codependency we see in this world and the selfishness that we see in this world, bless us for no more that kind of concept. Bless us too. Father, open our hearts, lift our vision higher without a redemptive vision. Listen to me. Without a redemptive vision, the people cast off restraint and the people perish. Because many people do not have a vision for themselves. They've got a vision of what their gifts and callings are, but they've never really become part of something bigger than themselves.
Yeah. You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.